Tonight is a night to celebrate Canada's 150th anniversary of Confederation and the Scots' contribution to the building of this country. I'd like to call on our club bard, Jim McLaughlin, to recite his poem, "The Scots Who Built This Canada." Jim?
Thank you. Just because I wrote it doesn't mean to say I remember it. 2017 is a year we all can celebrate Canada's historic rise and what has made her great. It marks an anniversary we scarce can disregard, and so it is a theme tonight, along with Scotland's bard. But now I'd like to add one more. I claim the floor's advantage, a tribute to our late, dear friend, the gentle Trevor Burbage. In 1867, after years of consultation, Confederation was proclaimed and we became a nation, while Newfoundland and PEI and the province of BC declined to join initially. In time, they did agree. 150 years have passed, so let us take the time to ponder some important facts I'll share with you in writing, to wit the role the Scots have played in Canada's success, a list of grand achievements that cannot but impress. The triumph of our nationhood was born of aspiration and near 200 years of toil and fierce determination by those who faced adversity while blazing new frontiers, the men and women owed so much, those early pioneers. First Nations people have a claim to lands they once did roam, but when the Europeans came, they too called this their home. These settlers flocked from far and wide, resolved to make a stand and give their all to start new lives in this great promised land. Chief among this stalwart crew was many an eager Scot, forsaking king and homeland both, to provide to improve his weary lot. So what became of all those Scots? What wealth did they create? What contributions can we say helped make this country great? The tales of their achievements date from 1702, when hardy men of Orkney were employed as fur trade crew. They labored with a stoic will in Hudson's Bay's harsh climate, with many rising through the ranks as leaders over time. Other Scots then followed who, with pioneering stealth, soon helped to open up the land and tap its resource wealth. They came in growing numbers through the 1800s on, now trading on their intellect much more than on their brawn. Unlike other immigrants from many another nation, most young Scots at home received a good basic education. Many took to industry as tradesmen, engineers, and some as leading businessmen or world-class financiers. But nationhood demanded one more monumental quest, to build a mighty railroad, rail of steel, a rail line east to west. It was John A. Macdonald made this national dream come true, our very first Prime Minister and Scotsman through and through. The project from the start was fraught with scandal and dissent, the soaring costs prohibitive, yet this did not prevent the wily old MacDonald nor the CP's high command from pressing on despite the odds, the naysayers all be damned. They toiled to carve the line across Muskeg and Granite Shield and over endless prairie lands of hardened sod and field, to reach for forbidding mountain pass and mud-filled slough and dike, until they reached Craigellachie and drove in that last spike. The historic blow was photographed, preserved forevermore, iconic of an age long past, now part of railway lore. The picture bending to the task, top-hatted, maul in hand, is C.P. Rail's Sir Duncan Smith, while all the others stand. Observing just behind him, though appearing lost in thought, the famous Sanford Fleming, each man, of course, a Scot. So what of all those of the others who aspire to high positions in commerce and in industry and able politicians? With fire in their bellies and the changes that they wrought, the record is quite clear on this, that most were born a Scot. The man who wonderful this nation first in all for 19 years, displayed both guile and statesmanship, eclipsing all his peers. John A. is well deserving of the nation's recognition as Canada's most honored son, at least in my submission. Although one other might compete for this much envied spot, but we all know Pierre Trudeau, his dear mother, was a Scot. Another Scot who saw a need and answered to the call, John Richardson, establishing the Bank of Montreal. As Canada's first chartered bank, it served to lead the way for other banks that flourish and are household names today. And at the risk of seeming smug, of these I can attest, most were founded by a Scot, as well you may have guessed. The list is long, my time's near gone, but not expired, not quite. There's Alexander Graham Bell, he well may call tonight. And much loved Tommy Douglas, whose great vision came to bear, ensuring all Canadians access to free health care. There's James McGill, George Brown as well, and Grant McEwen too. I'm nearly there, I've just three there. There's you, and you, and you. So ending with some other gifts we Scotsmen have endowed, we claim the sport of curling eye and golf, of which we're proud. And just before I leave it there, forgive me if I boast, 'twas we came up with single malts. So let us raise a toast to those who came before us and should never be forgot, to those that built this Canada, the high and lowland Scot.
Nice.
Thank you, Jim. Here's our taking and recital of the Scots who built this Canada.